We can start? All right. Everybody ready to start? Great. And let's go. Welcome to this presentation. My name is Niels van Molen. This is a talk about open social, the future of DevOps and open social. In this presentation, it's labeled a bit around four topics. First, an introduction in open social and me and the company. Then, welcome. Then the second concept is the theory about DevOps and microservices. So this is a bit of theoretical part of the talk. And then we look at continuous integration and delivery, what it is and what I think it is, basically. And then how we implemented continuous integration, delivery, and microservices in open social. So these are the four pillars. So an introduction. Yeah, my name, Niels van Molen. I'm a three-year Drupal developer for GoGorilla, a company. I have a master's degree in human media interaction, sort of computer science versus interaction and people, users. And in my job, I'm a developer, but I also do a lot of DevOps things, quality assurance, testing, especially functional testing, and thinking about the process as well. So the company I work for, GoGorilla, is currently like 25 people, where half of them are web developers, including front end. We do a lot more. We do design, we do marketing, basically everything you need for a website. It's a Drupal agency at this moment. You might know us from the Yoast CEO module and the Search Kruma module. That's what we created. There's our website. Okay, let's start. Yeah, we're a Drupal agency and we work for clients, basically. And we had this big project for Greenpeace called Greenpeace Greenwire, where they wanted us to make a platform for all their volunteers to connect and to participate, to create events, like a social platform for the people, the community of Greenpeace. And we did this. It started with one site for the Netherlands, and then it grew to like 18 departments of Greenpeace. So it went really big, and we have a website running in every continent now in Africa. The latest domain was published. And we were getting an award for this, a big important prize in the Netherlands. That you get, I think, for social and communities. So we got really acknowledgement that we did a good job on this. And we were getting a lot of requests from other people, like, hey, you made this for Greenpeace. Can you do it for us as well? And we didn't really have a good answer for them. We can make it, but we have to make it a whole platform for you. And that will cost a lot of money. So there are not a lot of people that have this kind of budget to create such a platform. So what we thought of, we started a crowdfunding campaign in the Netherlands. We sold some shares for like 200,000 euros, and they were gone in a week or something. And then we had some money, and we decided to build a sort of Drupal 8 distribution so other people can use it, so we can sell it to more than one client, and we can cooperate more with the Drupal community. And this is open social, make your people bloom. That's our slogan. Waiting for the pictures. So what's in open social now? Yeah, we're working on an MVP currently. It's will be a distribution for Drupal 8. And we're actually planning to release the first alpha version this week, tomorrow. And it looks good that we make this, so that's exciting. And it contains a lot of features. It is fully responsive on tablet, on mobile. It has topics like blog posts, discussion posts, events where people can enroll to see who has enrolled and create an event. Groups where people can connect with each other in a group and post content in a group, post events in a group. And we have a sort of like Facebook wall type thing where you can post your status, like not very formal, but well, connect and share information this way. And an activity stream at the moment where you can see what is happening in the community, what has been created, who has posted, who has commented on this. And I have a short video, because features are features and videos are more cool. We have a prototype as well, a hi-fi prototype, where we do a bit of style guide-based development. Here you see all the pages on there. This is an anonymous homepage. We have like an introduction block, an activity stream. You see some blocks on the right with events. You can, of course, sign up and create an account and log in. Yeah, now you have the logged-in user homepage where you can create posts and set the visibility of these posts. Like, is it for everybody or only for people in this community that have an account? The stream and the post will appear at the same overview where you can comment. And when you go to profile, you see everything about this person. So what he has posted anywhere. Or what he has created, the topics the user has created, the events and the groups. So we really base a lot on these three concepts at the moment. When you go to an event, you see that you can enroll. This user has enrolled already. You see who has enrolled. You can also cancel your enrollment from the header. Now we go to think groups. You see the amount of people that are in the group, that you have joined the group. And in a group you can also post again and create topics, events, and see the members. And you have overviews for this as well. Oh yeah. We have search functionality and an explore page, so where you can add a few more things. It's currently based on Drupal search, but we have a planning that you can plug in any search system you want for this. Notifications, important. So you have the stream, but also push notifications that are more visible and on every page. And profile, of course. I think we go there now. Where you can fill in information about the user. Yeah, about yourself, basically. And contact details, stuff like that. An account, which you can reset. So it's a very short, brief introduction. We put a lot of effort in the design as well. So not only features, but also that it works good and looks good, basically. Can I go to the next slide from here? I have to do this. Where's my mouse? There it is. So that's Open Social. Now we go to the exciting stuff. Yeah, Open Social is exciting as well, of course. We have really thinking about DevOps at this moment, because when you work for one client, it's different than you have like 100. And that's the idea of Open Social. So we have a lot of more requirements than we had before. Let's dive into this. I think DevOps, we have to define it first before we talk about it. And it's easy to define it about tools and go straight into the technical details. But I think DevOps is really about culture in a company. And it's good to have like an idea, what do we want from this culture? And I think it's these three things. Scientific experimentation, that we base things on data, that we try to test things, that we're not just building any feature, for example, if there's a request, but that we really look at what does a user need and can we verify that it's really a problem. That we want to improve and adapt on the environment, but also the clients and the requests, so that we can continuous improve it instead of making very big steps and then hope something happens. And a culture of sharing and contributing and collaboration. So yeah, people working together basically, and not fighting or competing in the product. So it's good to keep in mind when we go to the next slides. This is what we had before Agile, I think, and some people still have it. I know of a QA lead. Like you have these separate teams, and you push things over the wall, basically. So before this, there's a lot of other things like specs teams and things like that. But then when a development team has something done, it will send it to the QA team, they will approve it, and then it will send to the operation team, and they will deploy it, basically. But with Agile, we see that it's really more like this, that the development and the QA has become one. People are testing, developers know what the user wants, they have to know it, they have to write tests, they have to make sure they deliver quality and not depend on other people to make sure it has enough quality to be released. And this is actually what we see in our company as well. We have like no QA team, no testers. Yeah, we have testers like user testing and specialized people for that, but we don't expect every feature a developer makes that there's someone else testing it. We review each other work, of course, but not especially that. But we still have this operation team. We still, especially with clients, big clients, they have these departments. They don't trust us to do anything on their service. And yeah, I understand that a bit. So it's, but we still have this team where we have to cooperate with. Why is this? Well, like I think most of everyone here will use a monolithic architecture, how they host things. So we have a code, but also has to run in things like a web server to run Drupal, a database to store data, Redis for caching, etc., etc. And these are really static pieces set up on a machine, installed once. And operation, what do they do? So it's good to know what is the task of an operations team. I think who's a developer here? Maybe show hands. Who works on operations? Yeah, sort of. So, yeah, mostly developers. Yeah, I think it's good to know what are actually the tasks of people in operations departments. What do they need to do? Well, mainly providing a stable system and things that go with this, like monitoring, backups, logging, updating, making sure it's secure at the OS level, operation system level. And making sure the load balancing is set correctly, met the domain settings are correct. Making sure everything is in the correct state that it should be. And handle incident when there is an incident. They have to figure it out, of course. But what happens now, we have like this very connectivity between the operations people and the developers, how I call them. And there's a lot of frustrations I see. Like, especially I'm a developer, so I can talk mainly about the frustrations we have. But for us, it's very hard to get new environments from clients. For example, an acceptance environment, or we want to test something, or want to do something. Or it's also difficult to upgrade versions, PHP version, but also any other thing. It's very difficult to get something installed that is not there, like a Selenium server we had. To wait like a year for a client to get it, and we still don't have it. Yeah, things like this are really problems that we encounter. And it's also difficult to get the same development environment as the production environment to test things, to see bugs, because it's always changing. You don't really have control over your application. And when there are problems, it's not very clear who is the person responsible or what department. So sometimes there's a performance issue and development will get the thing. But it's the same the other way around. Sometimes there's a problem and the operations team has to deal with it while it's a development error. So it's not clear who's responsible for what problem, what we see. And for operations, also not really in their task to create new services, to work on this application. So they're really in a sport to do things development wants, and they want to have this stable system. And yeah, they have to do a lot of things that is not really their job, I think. So what's the solution? Well, this is an option. Have like one big team, including development, QA, and operations, everything in one. Could work, but I think it's way too big, and I think we can do better than this, basically. I think this is the solution creating a better system, like have an abstraction layer where developers can do their job on this application and have a lot of freedom as well, and where the operation people can do their job and connect with this infrastructure which you create in abstraction. Yeah, but this is very difficult to create in a monolithic architecture. I would not know how to create such an abstraction where developers can work and operation people can work and we'll all work together. It will be a lot of work. And you see this with cloud as well. Cloud does this a bit. I think we can do this too with Docker. I think that is the main solution for this. It's also what the concept is. The container, like you have these services which you want to use, which you want to run, and you want to abstract that somehow. And Docker does that. They will let you put this service into this container, basically. So a good analogy is that you have like a piano and you want to ship it somewhere. How would you do this with a car or something? It will be when there were no containers or no standardized things. You need something to put it in and then drive it through. If you have to like put a piano with ropes and stuff, it will be very difficult. And that's what we do now in our infrastructure a lot. The biggest difference, I think, is that the monolithic architecture is very updated infrequently. It's installed only once and then updated, maintained. And this is really simple to do. And this is the strength, I think, of this monolithic architecture, that you just install it once and then you can push code to it. You can host multiple sites. Yeah, it's pretty great for this. But for microservices, it is different. You have to build a new container every time you create something different. And this code is in this web server, basically. So the infrastructure updates as well when you update the code. And this will make it much more flexible. We'll just wait for the picture. it also stacks, because we have this container, an operation department doesn't have to know what's in the container. It only has to know what is in the what are the properties of this container. And sometimes these individual things like a web server and Solo will not fit very nicely. But when you have containers, it fits in general a bit more better on your servers, on your nodes, compared to a monolithic architecture. Now without these containers, we have like an open source, which we use. We share our code. But we do a lot of the same things with our infrastructure. We all have a web server, we all have a database, and it's almost always Apache and MySQL. We use a lot of similar infrastructure. While we only share it through documentation, which can get outdated very quickly. And with containers, you see this happening, that you not only share your code, but also share your infrastructure. And this, I think, probably one of the most important concepts in splitting it up in small services, that it's very easy to have like one base service and then derive your own service from this. So I call this open containers. And you also see this happening in the Docker Hub already. A lot of companies are creating these containers. A lot of people are contributing back and doing things. And you don't have to do it yourself anymore. You can basically take a container. And it's done. So a quick recap. I think microservices are a great way to create this abstraction. I think this abstraction is really useful to better collaborate on your infrastructure, on your DevOps. It has a cost. Monolithic is very simple to implement. The culture now is a monolith. So people have to learn how to use containers. And for developers, it's no problem. Developers love Docker, but I think the operation departments do not really like it yet. They're more conservative. So that's a big issue. It's not always a good fit for every project, but I think for our project, it's a very good fit. And for our goals. So the next part, continuous integration and delivery. Who knows what it is? Who knows what continuous integration is? Hands? Yeah, almost everyone. And continuous delivery? Nice. Great. And I know a bit how much you know. Yeah, continuous integration is, I think, the thing we do at Drupal.org as well. Find potential integration issues and issues with failing tests before you commit something to trunk, basically, or get as quick the results of these failing tests when they are there. And for us, it means like running all the functional tests, all the BA tests, and testing if the product builds, the project builds. But continuous delivery is much more. Continuous delivery, from the continuous integration system, that's like the first step of continuous delivery. There you will have like a thing that's complete, but as a business, you want to do much more steps before you release something, basically. Sometimes you do. For example, user testing, making sure the feature you built is correct. For example, performance testing and security audits. So the idea of continuous delivery is that you add more steps to it and that your release will be more reliable, that it works and that it doesn't contain any stupid things. And why not do this in CI? It's mainly because you need much more than just a script to run. You need environments, you need you need people to approve things. You have to have manual steps sometimes. And a big concept here is that you have one artifact that comes out of your continuous integration system and that you never rebuild this again in those steps. So you have an artifact, and if it passes, you will get the label, and then it can go to the next step. If that passes, it can go to the next step. But if it fails, the artifact cannot be released, basically. So something has to happen. You cannot change something and then skip these tests. You have to do it all over again. So that's an important step, especially when we look at Docker in a bit. Some concept of continuous delivery is that you measure the time it takes for each of those steps you want, and then to reduce the time necessary. So if it takes a long time, one step, that's a point of interest that you want to automate and make more efficient. Feature toggles, instead of long-living feature branches, it's much better to make a sort of feature toggle that you don't have to have this large merge of a year, and then you have to change everything. It will break a lot of things. And I think branch by abstraction will make sure you can build something and not have it enabled. And feature toggle as well. So you can build it in the same branch, but you don't destroy anything. You don't enable it on production unless it's ready. And the use of artifacts as Docker images we use for version control to release to an environment. So instead of releasing with Git, releasing the code from a monolithic to your nodes, you release it with a Docker image you have built. And that's a big concept as well. So you release the artifact and you don't release the code, basically. And for microservices, this is much more important to use these artifacts because every time the infrastructure is built again. So when you don't do testing on this, when you don't do the basic test, your application will fail much faster than when you just release code to a monolith. Okay, implementation in OpenSocial. What we used to do was with this monolith, we used Vagrant and Puppet to provision it, basically. And it works pretty nice, the concept is nice. but you're still provisioning a monolith. So what we saw that people were not provisioning very often. Not we had like a rule, do it every sprint. But in the end, very few people did this because we know that it causes problems. We know our monolithic is stable, our development, and we don't want to change it because it works now. And when you provision something that hasn't been tested very good, yeah, it can fail very easily. And it did. So people were scared to do this. and we released the production with Git and install scripts. Like we released code to this monolith. We used Jenkins for a CI system. And basically we ran a test every night on based on the master branch or develop branch. But not on every pull request. So every night tests were running. What we saw is that it was very difficult to get people to act on failing tests, because it was not very clear who did it, what was the problem. When a few tests fail, it's even more difficult to fix it. And no one was really doing this enough. So we had a lot of failing tests, and then we had to spend some more time and be very late to fix it. And it was much more difficult. And now we use this. So we have a feature branch, and create a pull request. When we commit something and push it, it will trigger a test immediately. So when you push something to your origin, it will run all the beta tests, all the unit tests, and run a build as well, create these Docker images. When we're done, we make a pull request. We have a reviewer, and then it also merges the original branch where you want to merge it in this branch, and run the test on this. That's very powerful. And the results are displayed in GitHub in the pull request. So we have a rule now that we never merge a pull request that has a failing cross in it. And that's very natural. Like, it has a cross, do not merge. But once it passes, everyone is happy, and then we merge it in master. And then Docker Hub starts, an automated build that will build a Docker image for us based on this newly created code. And this code is then in Jenkins, we have a nightly build, an environment, which runs every night, which retrieves this Docker image and does an install on an environment. So this is like the first step of a continuous delivery pipeline, how I see it. I will have a demo of this to give you a better idea about it. Yeah, I did this presentation at Drupal Gem as well, so it's called Drupal Gem, the branch. But when you push change, this is what we do as developers. We create things and we push it. And then automatically a build is triggered in Travis. So I didn't have to do anything. This was just, you see the Drupal demo hasn't started yet. I think we create a pull request now. So it has started, but just has to wait a little bit. And when you create a pull request, instead of doing one check, it will do two checks on the branch itself. So let's create this pull request. And here you see the first check of the push. And when we wait a little bit, there's the pull request check as well. And when we go to these checks, it's basically just a list of things you can do on Travis. So this is the list where we can install the containers, run the script. Yeah, sorry, it's a bit small. It has like commands to do things. Not very clever. Here it will run the create the images. Then run the install script. We have one install script we use over all environments for development, but also for Travis and the nightly build. It's important as well that we don't have separate scripts, because you also want to test your script, basically. Create some demo content, and then it passed. So the installation has been completed. Then we run a unit test, basically the Drupal core and our custom test. And we run the Selenium test then. So these are all BIAT steps. This is also a form of documentation, how we use it, Gherkin. So it's a readable test. You can see what is happening. The light's not very good, but it basically goes through your site, clicks on things, and tests it this way. And they all pass. And then when we go back to the pull request, you will see, one has been completed, the other one as well on the merge branch, because we didn't really change much there this time. But it's just the same checks, the same unit test for this. Refresh it, you see everything has passed, and now you can merge it, basically. So let's pretend we merge this. This was a demo thing, so we don't. But let's pretend we did. What then happens, if it's something is merged back in master, another thing will trigger. And that will happen on the Docker Hub. So we created an automated build in here. You can also do it manually, but I prefer automation. And here you see, based on settings in your Git, like the latest stack will be added. And in the Docker Hub, it will basically run your code in the web server. So it will basically create these containers with the code, which you then can use on any place. So you have tags. It's all automated. That's, I think, the most important part. And when we look at Jenkins, how are these images used? We just have a Jenkins job. And here we say, get the image, basically. It's very short. Do a Docker pool of a Docker Compose pool. It will get the images. It will install the images with the upd. And then it will basically install a script, or an install script, or an update script, whatever you want. For now, we don't support updating, so we just run the install script. And this will run every night at 5 a.m. And this will some log. This will result in a working website for our development team to test. This is also a pretty important step that we have like immediately feedback that's every day based on the master branch, that we can work on something during the sprint and not only at the sprint review. And here you see a working website with the latest code in it. So that's how it works. I have a bit less time than I thought, so I have to speed things up a little bit. How many minutes?
Six.
Okay. What we saw from these changes are that people really act on failing things. And Docker is really good for developers. We don't really experience any problems for setting this up compared to Vagrant and Puppet. The artifacts are also very good, I think, very fast. And all people care that this check will be green. When you work on something, it will be red very soon. Some test fails, you hate it. But people are helping each other, asking, like, what can I do to make this test pass? And the end result is that we never had a failing test in master so far. And nightly build was very useful as well. Quick, the concept of Docker. I think the most important concept you can know about Docker is images and containers. And during build, you make an image. And when you run something, you do it in a container. And basically, you have a Docker file to create an image. and Docker Compose and YAML file to run containers from these images. And I'll have to speed things up. Development specific tools and configurations. Yes, we are developers. We want a lot of things. We want Xdebug, Beat, Selenium things, caching settings that are off, a lot of things. And we had to make sure those work for developers, but not on the production side, basically. So how we solve this is create multiple files for Docker files for creating multiple images, do all the things you need to do at build time in these separate development images. And we have one root image that is like the stable one we can use for production. And as well, multiple compose files. We have like this development compose file and the production compose file, how to run your containers. And for Drupal settings, things you want to do during runtime. We used the environment variable in the settings.php to discriminate. So you basically can say in your Docker Compose file where you run the containers, this is a development or production environment. And base certain settings on that, like loading the local.settings.php in there. We have some links. You can try it out. We will release an alpha version of OpenSocial tomorrow, so you can download the code from Drupal.org. But we already have a GitHub where you can play around and see it happening. It's all open source. Every code, every Travis thing I saw, let you know. GetOpenSocial.com. We have some information there, and on Drupal.org we have some information as well, if you're interested. So what have we learned in this session? Well, first an introduction in the OpenSocial platform, microservices and Docker, how I think about them basically, and why I think they are important in our DevOps environment. Concept of continuous integration and delivery, why it's important that we especially with microservices, that you have really good systems for this. And our implementation, basically the feedback you get from Travis really proved to be worth the effort. Thank our sponsors of this event. Oh, thank you. And then we go to questions. Anything? Yes.
Yeah. In production environment, you update the containers after the build.
The question is, what about production deployments?
How do you manage the updates on production environments?
Yeah, how do you manage the, I have to repeat the question. How do you manage the deployments to the production environment, basically? Yeah, how I see it, we don't have a production environment yet for OpenSocial. But how I see it is that it's just another step of this continuous delivery pipeline, basically. So if all checks have passed, you just have to release this artifact that has been tested very thoroughly. And then just say Docker Compose up basically the script we had there, like pull the latest image and then up it. But there are some like database systems pose some problems. There's a big discussion in the microservices world now for databases, so that there is a case to be made to not add your database in this microservice, but have something else beside there. But yeah, basically for production, it isn't any different than your normal deployments, I think. Yes. Yeah, we don't have coding standards yet. Basically because it's not really that necessary. We all use PHP Storm, and we get feedback there, and basically we fix anything we see if it has the coding standards warning. But we did for other projects, so it will be just another step in the CI probably. But for coding standards there will be a lot of false positives, so things that are failing and that are not really error. So yeah, I don't really, if we're going to implement this, more about feedback than to really fail a build about it, I think. Yeah. Other questions? Oh, sorry, the question was of the last one, what about coding standards? So, for the video. Yes. Yeah. No, I heard about it from someone else, but I didn't really play around with it. But it looks good. Yeah, there's a lot of good tools out there. Travis as well has a lot of competitors. I'm basically not advocating tools. yeah, I think Docker is also important that it can run anywhere, like on any tool. And a lot of things are happening in this world in the cloud as well to make something like this. Yeah, so basically, if you have Docker, you can go, like, you have a lot of options. Question was about Rancher. Sorry. Keep forgetting. Any other questions or remarks? We have a sprint in OpenSource, so if you have think of questions or want to speak more personally, we're basically in the sprint room the whole weekend, so feel free to ask us there, basically. Thanks.